Welcome to a new episode of Biblical Life TV. Today we're going to be continuing our study on moving forward in our Jubilee Part 3. Over the last month or so, we've have had a lot of extensive traveling. We've also had a lot of winter weather that has hindered us taping as much as we would like to. I hope you enjoyed the videos from the Atlanta Leadership Conference. I pray that they were a blessing to you and that inspired you to take down your giants and to take your mountains. Now, because of all that we're doing with Biblical Life, we have had to adopt a new production schedule. Every week, when I first set this up, every week I was wanting to do a podcast for Biblical Life Deep Waters and a video. But with all the duties that we have going on with Biblical Life, college and seminary, and writing and our publishing ministry, it has become near impossible to do one every week. So we're entering into a new schedule of 1 week we do a podcast and the next week we do a video. We have also heard from many of our viewers that listen to both of them, and they say they're constantly in a state of trying to catch up. And so by slowing this down a little bit, it's going to be a little bit easier on us, and it's going to be easier on our viewers. I'm also planning, after we complete this series, that we're going to be starting a new series dealing verse by verse on 1 John. The more that I pray, the more that I seek the face of God, I see that 1 John is connected to the book of Revelation. Both of them were penned within a short period of time by the Apostle John. It was some of the last books written in the New Testament. And I believe in 1 John, he gives us the information that we need as we begin to see the book of Revelation unfolding before us so that we don't get duped by the enemy, so that we have the strength to make it through and be victorious in Christ. And I'm looking forward to that. I'm hoping that by the time we end the video series, that we're also going to have a professionally printed study guide that you can use for your home fellowship or personal use. Now back to our study. In episode 1, I outlined steps to move forward in the right direction. Part of what I believe Jubilee is, it is a specific anointing from God and a time period from God. We have an open heaven that we can begin setting things in order in our lives. And the enemy takes advantage of us that we tend to wander spiritually, that if we don't have these visitations from God and touches from heaven, we tend to begin to spiritually wander and lose our way. And so God said, listen, every 50th year, or this concept of Jubilee, is that I will come and I will give you a supernatural anointing so that you can begin taking inventory. You can give back to the devil all the stuff he's put into your life, and you can begin reestablishing kingdom of God in your life and demand your destiny comes back, your anointing comes back, your destiny comes back, your purpose comes back so that you can move forward in Christ. Now, I gave a basic outline of where we were headed. We've already dealt with prayer and worship in the home. I think that we have turned church today as something that is a spectator sport. You go and you're entertained for an hour or two. You pray with them there, but you never pray and worship at home. We need the Paul said to pray without ceasing. We need to keep that communication going with God all the time. And we also need to find times in our life to praise and to worship God. I shared in the last session how that I even used time on the elliptical walker, that this listening to good praise and worship actually helps the time go more quickly on the elliptical walker, but also my spirit and my soul are worshiping God, and so I'm able to do two things at one time, and it brings me closer to God. The second thing that we're going to be dealing with it today is the power of Sabbath in the home. And then finally, we're going to deal with about becoming kingdom conscious. And if there was ever a time in our lives to become kingdom conscious, it's today, because we have two competing kingdoms that are fighting for the attention of mankind. The kingdom of darkness right now is ruling in the halls of justice, is ruling in government, is ruling in the university, is ruling within the public eye. And they want to get rid of this word any way that they can, because it helps us understand the way the kingdom of God operates, how to enter the kingdom of God through the shed blood of Jesus Christ, and how to make him our king, that we're walking with him in spirit and in truth each and every day. Now, I want to deal this morning with understanding the foundational understanding of the Sabbath. If you have your Bibles, I want to go to Genesis chapter 2, verses 2 and 3. And it reads this way: by the seventh day, God completed his work which he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had done. Then God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because in it he rested from all the work which he had created and made. Now, one of the things I want you to understand first is that God blessed the seventh day. Now, in all the other days, he saw that it was good, but he didn't bless it. The first real blessing we see is when he created man and woman, and he blessed them, and he spoke words of authority into them. And then on the seventh day, God rested, but he also blessed that day, which means on the seventh day, there is a specific blessing from God. There is a specific anointing from God. If I will rest from my labors on that day, that there is a blessing that I can receive. And that same blessing, the way that it's phrased in the Hebrew, the same blessing, that continuity of blessing when he spoke dominion into man, is that same type of blessing, that there is a, still today, there is a blessing in the seventh day, that if I will set myself apart and cease from my labors and remember God, that there's something that I can enter into to receive that blessing. The second thing we see is he sanctified the Sabbath. Sanctified in Hebrew is kadosh, which means to consecrate, to sanctify, prepare, dedicate, to be hallowed, to be holy, to be sanctified, or be separate. In other words, he separated the seventh day and he made it holy. There's a concept of that sanctification. He set it apart unto himself and said, this day there is a specific blessing, that I'm doing this as a pattern for mankind. Isn't that what Jesus said? He said, Sabbath was made for the man, not man for the Sabbath. He was setting a priority. God did this for our benefit. And right now what I'm hearing in so many in ministry and so many in the body of Christ is how weary they are. I read a book here not too long ago that was dealing from a naturopathic point of view, and they've said even the way that the gravitational or the magnetic fields are on the earth and how all that kind of lines up, on the Sabbath from Friday night to Saturday night, they have discovered that everything on this planet is perfectly aligned so that you can receive the maximum amount of rest if you'll enter into it. I think God knew what he was doing. That he made the Sabbath for us. That number one, if we don't do it, we never really enter into that supernatural rest that can come from God. Secondly, if we don't do it, we begin to forget who the Creator is. We'll get to this in just a minute. But there's so much tied in to the Sabbath. Now, first of all, Sabbath and creation. When we recognize that Almighty God is the Creator, which is what Sabbath is about, I can create and continue the creation process in that I'm working, I'm creating wealth, I'm taking care of my family, I'm building a ministry or whatever. I do that for 6 days. But on the seventh day, I pause from all that, realizing and recognizing that all the strength, the wisdom, and the ability I have comes from Almighty God, the God of heaven and earth, the Creator. And see, this is one of the things the world does not want to do, because if I recognize a Creator and that he has a creation and I'm part of that, then I am answerable to that Creator. That's one of the reasons why they're trying to expunge the understanding of God from public society, sinful man does not want to recognize that he is accountable to a holy God. And their antidote, or their antithesis to the creation and recognizing the God of creation and our accountability to him, is a concept called evolution. And evolution says man is simply an evolved animal. And so man has these animalistic tendencies, and if he was just caused by evolution, just by the natural evolving of things, he is not answerable to anyone. That there is no creator, therefore there is no one that we must hold ourselves accountable to with what we do with our lives or how we conduct ourselves. In fact, many that have embraced evolution, like philosopher Friedrich Nietzsche, he wrote a book called Beyond Good and Evil. He was looking for this Übermensch, this new man that when he came, he would be so evolved, he couldn't be bothered with concepts such as good and evil, that whatever he chose to do was right because he chose to do it. You know, concepts like that fueled the Nazi movement, is fueling humanism today. That's why instead of calling sin, sin today, we can just get enough people to march on Washington or march somewhere and begin to change the ideas within society that it is no longer sin because they don't believe they have to hold themselves accountable to anyone. When I understand the concept of the Sabbath and respecting and giving honor to the Creator, all that falls away. I've got to look to his moral code on how to live. I've got to deal with the cross of Christ, and I've got to surrender him and to let his blood cleanse me of every sin, because I cannot outmarch or protest against what God has called sin and ever change it. That one day every single one of us will appear before his throne. And we're going to have to say, this is how I lived my life. And God said, these were the standards. They're unalterable. And now you must give an account. So the Sabbath is a vital part of that. No wonder Satan hates the concept of Sabbath so much. Now let's go to Exodus chapter 31, verses 12 and 4 through 14. And the Lord spake to Moses, saying, but as for you, speak to the sons of Israel, saying, you shall surely observe the Sabbath, for this is a sign between me and you throughout your generations, that you may know that I am the Lord who sanctifies you. Therefore you are to observe the Sabbath, for it is holy. That it is a sign of the covenant. And through Jesus, we have been brought into covenant to Almighty God. And so when I begin keeping the Sabbath, now let me stop right here and say, the Sabbath is not about what day you have church on. The Sabbath, what we're approaching, is what you do in the home. It's bringing spirituality back into the home. Now, I'm not against having church on Saturday or having church on Sunday. If you have church on Sunday, don't call it the Sabbath. In fact, over the years, as I've been teaching this, I've got to minister to many of our students that their fathers were very successful in ministry. And I would be amazed at when they catch the concept of the Sabbath. They said, you know what, Dad, from Friday night and all day Saturday, he did nothing but just get into the presence of God and get into the Word. And on Sunday morning, he would explode in the pulpit. Well, he was observing the Sabbath. He rested from everything and drew from that rest, drew from that special time that was consecrated and anointed by God to meet with him. And then he would pour forth everything that God had deposited in him on Sunday morning. And that's fine. But we need to realize if I start keeping the Sabbath, then it is a sign between me and God and a sign to the world that I'm walking with the God of creation. Now let's go to the Decalogue or the Ten Commandments. Exodus chapter 20, verses 8 through 11. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the Sabbath day The seventh day is a Sabbath of the Lord your God. In it you shall not do any work, you or your sons or your daughters or your male or female servants or your cattle or your sojourners who stay with you. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth and the sea and all that is in them, and rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the seventh day and made it holy. And so part of the Ten Commandments, the Decalogue, the very foundation, the Ten Commandments is a Reader's Digest version of all the commandments of God. And in it, he says, you must remember the Sabbath to keep it holy. And before that, he said, remember, I am the Lord God who brought you out of Egypt. Now, we as Christians can look at that and say, listen, I am the Lord God who brought you out of the world. I'm the Lord God who saved your soul. I'm the Lord God who went to the cross and redeemed you by my blood. So keep the Sabbath and keep it holy. Now, one of the things that I noted as I was reading this, there's only two lengthy commandments in the Ten Commandments. Some of them are very short. Thou shalt not kill. Thou shalt not steal. The two of the longest ones are about committing idolatry and violating the Sabbath. And I believe that extra instruction was there because he knew we would wander. And I also believe there is a connection between idolatry and leaving the Sabbath. Need to think about that for a minute. In fact, I have seen people take the Ten Commandments, and the first five deal with how we treat God, and the second five deal with how we treat us, but there's also a corresponding link between the two. And if you take, remember the Sabbath, you go across and it says, do not bear false witness. And so so could it very possibly be when we don't keep the Sabbath, we are bearing false witness about the God that we serve? Something to ponder. Now, the next thing we need to ask is, who changed the Sabbath? And people will say in the early church, they changed the Sabbath. Yet when we look in Acts chapter 15, where the instruction was given on how to handle the Gentiles in the church, they were commanded to learn Moses every Sabbath. And there is nothing in the Word that would ever actually take that out of the equation for the Gentile church. But I want to look at a couple things. There was Thomas Aquinas, and he wrote this in 1247. In the New Law, the observance of the Lord's Day took the place of the observance of the Sabbath, not by virtue of the precept or fourth commandment, but by the institution of the church. And see, what we need to realize, and I think because we've not studied everything that happened in the Catholic Church and the whole thing about the Reformation, when Constantine said, let us have nothing in common with the Jews, that was one of his first declarations at the Council at Nicaea. That means all of God's laws are set aside. All of God's feasts are set aside. God's Sabbath is set aside, and the Catholic Church began to write new laws. And we as Protestants removed centuries past that. We're doing things out of tradition, not realizing that it was Catholic law that they placed above the Word of God. And there was nothing biblically, there was nothing they could exegete out of this book to do it. They simply chose to do it. The word Catholic means universal. And so it was a universal church that all religions could come in. And those that understand esoteric religions or the mystery religions can be a vital part of what the Catholic Church does, because they simply took everything that they were doing and put a Christian or biblical sounding name on it, yet it's the exact same practices. Those are the ones who moved us from Saturday to Sunday on worship of God. Now, this is a part of the historical Lutheran Augsbury Confession in 1530. And it says, they, the Catholics, refer to the Sabbath day as having been changed into the Lord's Day, contrary to the Decalogue, as it seems. Great, they say, is the power of the Church, or i.e. the Roman Catholic Church, since it has dispensed with one of the Ten Commandments. So instead of saying, listen, I'm troubled here that they got rid of one of the Ten Commandments, it's saying, behold the power of the Catholic Church. They got rid of one of God's commandments and replaced it with something else. Constantine's proclamation on March 7th, 321 says, all judges and city people and the craftsmen shall rest upon the venerable day of the sun, S-U-N. He had simply thought Jesus was another reincarnation of Mithra or Apollos, and that he was a sun god. And if you have any understanding of the Word of God and the Christian faith and our Judeo-Christian heritage is the antithesis to paganism, to that which was derived out of Babylon. And yet we over and over again see Constantine confusing Mithra and Solus Victoris. All of that he confuses with Jesus. And so as an imperial decree, he said everybody is going to rest on the day of the S-U-N, that sun, because it was sun worship. Now I want you to listen to the Council of Laodicea. Christians must not Judaize by resting on the Sabbath, but must work on that day, rather honoring the Lord's day, and if they can, resting then as Christians. But if any shall be found to be Judaizers, let them be shut from Christ, or i.e. kicked out of the Catholic Church. Now there's several things about this that we need to deal with. Remember the church that Jesus had the most problems with in the book of Revelation. It was the Laodicean church. And he said, you had become lukewarm and I'm about to spew you out of my mouth. It was in that city that this council met and decreed that that no Christian should ever keep the Sabbath. Now, I don't know about you, but that makes it suspicious to me. But they also set a precept that to this day is still recognized and enforced by the Catholic Church. The Catholic Church, their theological stance is, as long as you worship and you call Sunday the Sabbath, and so you are a Sunday keeper, you, and if you're a Protestant, you are just an erring child of the Catholic Church, and one day you will you'll come home to that one world religion. The moment you start keeping Sabbath, you are no longer connected to the Catholic Church. Just something to think about. We also find in Scripture, in Isaiah chapter 66, verses 22 and 23. Now listen to this. He's describing the new heaven and new earth, which we get in the back of the book of Revelation. He's describing some of the ways that it's going to function after we get to the end of things, this universe ceases to exist, that we're going to have a new planet to live on, that even the physics are going to be different, that you're not going to need a sun to have light, and there'll be no such thing as a shadow. There'll be no death, no corruption, no sickness, no disease. I want you to listen to what Isaiah is prophesying about this. And it says, for just as the new heavens and new earth, which I will make endure before me, declares the Lord, so your offspring and your name will endure. And it shall be from new moon to new moon, and from Sabbath to Sabbath, all mankind will come and bow down before me. Now here's my quandary. If Jesus celebrated the Sabbath, Paul met on the Sabbath. In fact, it was one of Paul's outreaches. If you read the book of Acts, he would go into the synagogues and he would first preach Christ to the Jews. And then there were what are called God-fearers. Cornelius was a God-fearer in the book of Acts. That meant that he kept the commandments, that he kept the Sabbath, he kept the feast. He did everything but be circumcised. That's what a God-fearer was. And Paul's gospel was, listen, God wants the circumcision of the heart, not of the flesh. And so then he would turn to the God-fearers that had done everything but to be physically circumcised, and he would preach Christ to them and show how Christ would circumcise their hearts if they would receive him as Savior and trust in his completed work on the cross. And so he reached out on the Sabbath. He always kept the Sabbath. And even when they met on what we call the first day of the week, if you understand that biblically the day starts at sunset, not sunrise. And so they would do things, they would follow Acts chapter 15, they would listen to the teaching of Moses on Sabbath by the rabbis, and then that evening there would be a community meal. And then they could begin dealing with these things about Christ separate from the synagogue service. And so it was on Saturday evening that they would gather together. That's why Paul was able to preach so long that someone fell out of a window and ended up breaking their neck, and he prayed for them and God raised them from the dead. It wasn't because he preached so long on Sunday morning. It was because he was preaching late into Saturday night, because that's when the first day of the week occurred. But in the new heaven and new earth, we're still going to be doing the Sabbath. Now, the Sabbath is not about what day of the week that you have church on. And you can, I mean, most of us have church services almost every day anyway. And when you even look back at the synagogal pattern, they met daily for prayer. They met daily to discuss Scripture. It's about what you do in your home. We need to turn Christianity from a spectator sport that we simply go on Sunday or we go to our service, we do that little bit for 2 hours, and think that we're good for the week. One of the things the Catholic Church did do very successfully is it separated the family from the spirituality. In fact, when I was over in Germany, when I was in the military, I could see some of the same attitudes. It's like, you know, if you really need to hear God, you go find a preacher. If you want to know something about the Word, you go find a preacher. Because he's doing his thing, just like if you're sick, you go to a doctor. But they really had no responsibility themselves to get into the Word, to pray, to begin ordering their lives by the Word of God. And the Catholic Church has done that because they're for a long... And the Catholic Church, if you understand the Reformation, part of the Reformation was the right to have this, for us to be able to read it ourselves. There were many of the early reformers that were burned at the stake or declared heretics simply for putting the Word of God into the common language of the people so that they could read it. It was the priest that did everything, and that's where the center of spirituality was. The center of spirituality needs to become the home again. Keeping Sabbath, some of the things I'm going to get into about what we do with the Sabbath, is so important. Because it brings our, when we look at what the way things are going right now, and we structured our church a lot of the ways the way the Catholic Church did it, we just took out some of the ritual we didn't like. Is we emasculate the head of every household and put it on the pastor or the bishop of the church rather than him. The highest authority in the home is the husband, and if you're not married, then it's the wife. Or the woman of the household. But it's there. It's not the pastor. The church gatherings we do are to supplement what you've been doing all week and what you have done on the Sabbath within your home. And so I want to look at some of the things of bringing back into the home the things that God never intended to leave. The first one is recognizing the Sabbath and the Lord of the Sabbath and entering into that supernatural rest. I remember the first time, and Mary and I were studying these things out, and so we said, let's try it. Let's see what happens. And so we got the candles out, and she said her prayer of thanking God that he created a way of salvation for both the Jew and the Gentile through Messiah, and just welcomed in the Sabbath, and then I prayed, and the presence of God came in so strong, it startled us. And I remember turning to her and saying, you know what, if we could get this level of God's presence into a church, there wouldn't be a building big enough to hold it. God made a point that day. I recognized them and she recognized them as the patriarch and the matriarch of the home. We recognized Almighty God, the God of heaven and earth, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, Yahweh Elohim, as the creator. And we entered into the pattern of the things that he established for us. And when he did, that blessing manifested in the presence of God. Always remember to welcome the Sabbath and to give God the recognition. Second, a part of the Ev Shabbat meal, or that Friday night meal, they would start it by breaking the bread, blessing the bread, and blessing the wine. Now, what's interesting about that is when you study it, the rabbis trace it all the way back to when Melchizedek met with Abraham and taught him the secrets of the bread and wine, and that was then encoded into the Sabbath. And I believe it was encoded into the Sabbath because it shows that when Messiah comes, that he's going to give you a supernatural ability to enter into the rest of God. And so you have a right, the head of every household has a right to give communion to his family. And it's embedded in that Ev Shabbat meal. Now, I remember as a young man, I was called to ministry in the Missionary Baptist Church. And my grandfather was a veteran minister in that church. In fact, I think he was in his late 70s, early 80s. And when he passed away, he was actually the oldest living minister within the Missionary Baptist Association. And I remember as a young preacher, and I'd surrendered to preach on my 13th birthday, I asked him, I said, you know, how do you do communion? And his first thing was, it must be done by an ordained minister. He never gave me scripture for that. Because that goes back to the Catholic Church. And when a Catholic priest, through what they call apostolic succession, which is actually part of the mystery religions, is that he was given a supernatural ability to take that bread and that wine and to turn it, it's called transubstantiation, that he can literally cause it to become the body and the blood of Christ. They also believe every time they do Mass that they are re-crucifying Christ on behalf of the people. It becomes the daily sin offering. And so from that, as Protestants, as a Baptist, we just simply say it must be a licensed or ordained minister. How many know we don't get any supernatural powers for transubstantiation? That's something that was drawn out of occult religion. It's not in the Word of God. When you look at the pattern, it was the head of the household every Friday night that broke the bread, then blessed the bread and blessed the wine. At Passover, it was the duty of the head of the household to give Passover. And later on, Jesus took the Passover and he interpreted it about himself and reduced it to bread and wine. So head of the household, you have the right to have communion with your family every Friday night. And I could get into an entire teaching on the spiritual principles of communion and how it brings healing to our bodies. It remembers us to stay cross-centered in our lives. And to make sure that, and just to see God and say, God, I want the blood of Jesus to cover everything in me. I don't want any unconfessed sin or unrealized sin. And I want my life to manifest the broken body of Jesus. That he was bruised for my iniquity, so he wants generational tendencies broken off of my life. That his body was bruised and beaten so that I might have healing. And so as I enter into this divine day of rest, I'm receiving healing. I'm receiving forgiveness. I remember. There's a whole teaching we can do on remember. That a lot of things that God gave us the feast and gave us the Sabbath to remember. Communion is about remembering the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. In fact, there's some powerful things that when God would remember, heaven would go into motion. And I think that was a pattern for us. So keeping communion in the home is extremely vital. It's part of bringing that back into the home. And then after the meal, the father of the household would teach. And what Mary and I have found is that I'll have a small teaching for the adults, and she loves to teach the grandchildren something about walking with God and making the Bible stories come alive. And it doesn't have to be long. It can be 5-10 minutes is all it needs to be. But it reestablishes spiritual authority in the home. Mom and Dad are getting into the Word, and they're sharing with their family. And with us, we're sharing with not only our children, but our grandchildren, the things of the Word of God. And so they're learning it at home. I remember here a few weeks ago as we were entering into this that Mary sat down before we did our communion, and she led both of my grandsons to the Lord right at the communion table. Isn't that a better place to lead them? To have mom or dad or grandma or grandpa lead them to Christ. Spurgeon said it was best to lead children to the Lord while they're still on your knee. And so that's a vital place. You're constantly teaching them what Jesus did for them. And then when they get old enough to understand, inviting them into that covenant. Oh, it's a powerful thing. And then a patriarchal blessing. You know, it seems today that in American households, there's more curses released than blessing. We get aggravated at our children. We tell them how dumb they are, how clumsy they are. And most of us have memories of these things being spoken into our lives. Well, the opposite of that is the patriarchal blessing. That I can lay my hands on my children and begin to speak God's blessing onto them. And when we see in the Word of God a man of God in covenant with God, when he speaks forth a patriarchal blessing, it's stuck in their lives. You know, an interesting study was done in Florida about those in prison. And within the active Jewish community that practiced the Sabbath and practiced speaking that patriarchal blessing, I believe it was less than 0.5% of those kids ever ended up in jail. It's because what the father spoke was more powerful than what the enemy had intended. Years ago, back in the early 90s, this was even before I began keeping the Sabbath. I was at a conference that Dr. John Garr had put together. He brought me in as an educational consultant. And I was just learning back then of the Hebraic heritage that we have in Christ. And there was a man that said that was sharing his testimony. He said that he began to learn these things, and his kids were almost raised. His son was 15, 16, full of rebellion. And he began to practice this. And so every Ev Shabbat, he would lay his hands on that rebellious child and tell him how good he was. And begin to speak a destiny of loving God and having a wonderful family and all these things into this kid's heart. He said that he began to slowly change. That rebellion died down. He made Christ the Lord of his life and really began to try to walk very diligently with the Lord. And then it came time for him to go off to college. And he had been busy doing things that night and packing because he had to leave Saturday morning to go to college, the way that everything kind of worked out for him. And he said that night he couldn't make Ev Shabbat at the home, but he said, my son woke me up at 5:00 Saturday morning. He said, I looked in the eyes of that child that used to be so rebellious. And all he wanted me to do was for me to lay my hands on him and to pray over him before he went to college. Oh. It's time for us to welcome the Holy Spirit back into our homes. It's time that we protect the presence of God in our homes just as much as we would in a church service. To invite God to come in and to rule and to reign, and the Sabbath is a vital part of it. But one of the things I think that has been a conundrum for those of us who have been teaching this, and there's been so many wonderful men and women of God been teaching it longer than I have, is that we can teach this and teach this and teach this. Now, what I've found, I've gone into large congregations and simply begin to unveil the power of the Sabbath, the power of the feast, the power of our Hebraic heritage. And you could almost take that congregation, you could divide up into three sections. The first would be, this is what I've been looking for. The Spirit of God is burning on the inside of my heart as you share this. This is the pieces of the puzzle that we needed. We want more information because we're going to implement it. And then you have the middle section. I don't care. I'm just comfortable. They're literally the Laodicean church. What I'm doing is good enough. I don't have to change anything. I'm comfortable enough. I think I'm going to get to heaven, blah, 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 blah. And then you have the third section that want to tar and feather you. I'm not going to do any of that because I don't care what the Word of God says. This is my tradition and this is what I'm going to do. In fact, I've got a doctoral student right now that part of his doctorate ministry project is he's developing a system of sharing some of these truths with those in the church. And he said, part of my quandary is it is just so slow coming. They can see it. They see it clearly in the Word. It follows us from Genesis to Revelation. But he said, sometimes I feel like they're a turtle moving backwards. And this is what I have determined through all the years that I've been doing this. Understanding our Hebraic heritage is a spiritual awakening. And right now I believe that God is awakening the remnant all around the world. Understanding our Hebraic heritage is a cross-denominational movement of God that you cannot point to one man. You can't say this began with Dr. So-and-so or Bishop So-and-so here, or even Rabbi So-and-so. That we're getting stories of people out in the wilderness, out in the jungles of Africa, that one day they wake up and realize there's something I've been missing, and the Holy Spirit's beginning to deal with me about the Sabbath and the feast. This is a move of God, and there's a spiritual awakening, and I believe that keeping the Sabbath is the gateway to really properly understanding our Hebraic heritage, and we need to make sure that we do it in balance. Jesus is the epicenter of all things. The reason I, as a Gentile, can enter into the Sabbath is that because of the shed blood of Jesus and the cross of Christ, I have been grafted into Israel, is what the Apostle Paul establishes so eloquently in the book of Romans. We didn't replace Israel, we were grafted into Israel, and their roots support us in what God did with his people. And so everything that I do, Jesus must be the epicenter of it. The reason that I keep his commandments is the exact reason that Jesus said this phrase, if you love me, keep my commandments. I don't do any of the commandments because I'm trying to earn his love. It's because I have received his love. And now I am reciprocating that love. I'm demonstrating my love by entering into his ways and walking with him and keeping his Sabbaths and being aware of his commandments and letting those things be boundaries of holiness within my life, that as I begin to function, I always function in the kingdom. I always function in the ways of God. And because I understand I have studied his commandments, I understand the difference between clean and unclean, holy and profane, so that as the world tries to constantly add things into my life, I can say, no, that does not line up with the Word, does not line up with the character or nature of God, nor his commandments. I deem that profane, and I push that out of my life, and so it allows me to have more room to bring in the kingdom of God into my life. And so if you're new to some of this, what I ask right now in the name of Jesus is that God would give you a spiritual awakening to understand what he wants to do with the Sabbath, to understand what he wants to do with the commandments. The Ten Commandments are all still enforced today. The commandments of God, there's 613 in Torah. And we get all upset about that, but there's over 1,200 in the New Testament. If we're going to function in a legal kingdom, we've got to understand the law, and it's God's law. It's not man-made law. It's not law that has been decreed by Rome. It was law decreed by the very throne of our Heavenly Father. and it's time to enter back into that. Let's pray today. Father, I just thank you for everyone who watches this broadcast today. Father, I just ask that that spiritual awakening would happen in their lives, that they would hunger and thirst after righteousness, that as they dig deep into these things, they're going to discover new and wonderful things about what Jesus has done for us and discover the rich heritage that we have been disenfranchised from over the years, and that we can reconnect and that we can become part of the remnant that is alive and vibrant in the last days, serving Jesus with our whole heart, walking in his ways and in his commandments because of love. My love for him empowers me to walk and fulfill the law. And Father, I believe you're loosening anointing on our lives to do it today. And I thank you and I praise you for it in Jesus' name.
For a deeper study of the Sabbath, we have an 8-part audio series entitled The Sabbath, a Biblical Investigation. This free MP3 study is available at our digital library at www.biblicallifeassembly.org.